Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Sameer Parekh. I'm a psychiatrist. I'm the director of the Fortis National Mental Health Program. Thank you, HealthWire Media, for having this initiative, Prioritizing Mental Health. I truly believe that prioritization of mental health is the need of the hour. As we stand today, we are a few days away from the World Suicide Prevention Day. We are a month or so away from the World Mental Health Day. It's so important for all of us to understand that our mental well-being is as integral to our life, our health, our societal, personal, physical well-being as our health is. Now, if we have a stomach ache, we go to a gastroenterologist. For sugar problem, you go to a diabetologist. For a cardiac problem, you go to a cardiologist. It's time we understand that mental ailments are as much a health problem like any other health issue. Before I come to the COVID times, let's understand a couple of things. Suicide is amongst the 10 top killers in the world. We all need to come together because suicide prevention is a reality. And if all of us work together, we can actually work towards suicide prevention. We have almost 800% shortage of experts in our country. So it's not that expertization alone of mental health is the solution. The solution is life skills building, positivity, social support, values, family, colleagues, our social connectedness, social responsibility, building our collective and individual resilience. That's how we take care of mental health of ourselves, our family, our friends, and society by large. Let's look at the COVID times. It's my firm belief that those individuals and families who are connected with each other, who have solid good support systems, their outcomes post-COVID would be so much better than those people who've not been able to find support from their friends and family. So if there is only one thing that is important in our fight against COVID, it is our connectedness. So stay connected. Keep checking out on your friends and family. Ask them how they are doing. If you are struggling, unmute yourself. Share with people. It's okay. If you can share, I have headache, I have a cold, I have a cough, I have fever. You can also share, I'm not sleeping well, I'm having a bit of anxiety, I am feeling stress. That's how you understand and you talk about your mental health concerns. Broadly, there are three kinds of anxieties people have been coming to me with during COVID times. Anxiety about getting the illness. I think this is a good anxiety to have because it will ensure that you will do all that you can to prevent the illness, which means you will follow medical advisories, government guidelines, you'll use masks, sanitization, and you'll ensure that you create a fortress for you, your family, and your colleagues and prevent COVID from entering your homes. And for this, you need to be careful. All of us, for example, mask is not a discretion. You wear it properly, not like this, right? You avoid crowded places. You keep distance. You sanitize. The more you take care of these preventive components, you'll start feeling a lot better because you will feel confident that yes, I'm doing what I can. Your anxiety will be taken care of. Don't read information which is not verified. Don't pass on messages which are not from verifiable sources of experts. And don't keep on tracking on the number and data. You focus on what preventive techniques you can follow. When it comes to anxiety, second anxiety is the anxiety of the uncertain future. My thought, future is uncertain because we are all evolving. Worldwide, we are evolving. We don't know what's going to happen next. Let's accept it. So rather than thinking about the long distant future, you think about here and now. My mantra for you is one day at a time. Only today is what you think about. And three things for today: productivity, positivity, connectivity. Stay productive. Do whatever best you can. Don't be self-critical. Don't compare yourself to those times which were pre-COVID times. Those were different times. Right now are different times. Include the work you do from home also as a part of your productivity. And then you stay positive. In fact, you spread positivity. You spread positivity to your friends, to your family, to your colleagues, so that everybody becomes more and more resilient. And then you go to the next step, which is stay connected. It's our connections which define us. And that's what's going to bring the anxiety of uncertainty down for all of us. The third component is, how do you deal with this new normal? My suggestion, start your day on time. Have good physical activity. Have a well-balanced lifestyle. Except that your sleep may have reduced a little bit, doesn't matter. But keep your wake-up time fixed. Create a workstation. If you're a student, create a study station. Have a work window. Start on time. Hard stop. End on time. Once you've done that, have a lot of connectedness with your colleagues. Use lots of video calls, voice calls, over text, so that you feel a sense of camaraderie and togetherness. In your free time, do some new things. Pick up some hobbies. Meal times, family times, TV times, family times. Board games. If you have young children, give them a lot of physical activity, board games, and ensure that they feel the right kind of stimulation. If you have teenagers at home, encourage them to keep talking to their friends. Peer support matters a lot to them. If you have senior citizens at home, make sure you don't let them spend alone time. Only rest, only sleep is when they should be in their room. Otherwise, they should be with everybody else. Put all of this together. That's how you deal with the new normal. During this, if you feel anxiety, you talk to someone. You share. You don't hesitate to open up. That's the way to balance your mental health during these times. You want to know more about this? I've written a book, Don't Worry. And this is how you keep your mind fit during a pandemic. It's a Rupa publication. It's an e-reader. Feel free to download it. I'll now start taking some questions. Narendranath Mishraji, you had a question. What is the primary symptom of mental stress? See, what would happen is, there's a trigger. You are giving it a reaction. It may affect your thoughts. It may affect your moods. It may affect your behavior, your productivity, your lifestyle. If any of these things start getting affected and you're not feeling good, you may well be under stress. First step, recognize it. Second step, talk about it. Third step, try to find solutions. And then if need be, talk to an expert. Vaibhav Ratra, your question is the ways to prevent suicide. I appreciate your question. Like I said, World Suicide Prevention Day is around the corner. I talk about the Werther and the Papageno phenomena. Werther syndrome is based on a book that was years back written, The Sorrows of Young Werther, which led to more suicides of young people who identified with Werther, bringing in the concept copycat suicides or the Werther syndrome. Opposite of that is the Papageno's effect. Mozart, magic flute, Papageno in similar thought process, but Papageno's friends show him that world is worth living for. Friends, family, life, joys of living. So Papageno's effect is what is needed. All of us need to spread positivity. Right now, join a campaign that I am doing, Papageno Learns. Share positivity. Share that joys of living. Life is beautiful. Unmute yourself. End the stigma. Family matters. Friends count. Stay positive. And if you are struggling, open up, talk to somebody. There are suicide prevention helplines. We run a 24-hour helpline in 16 Indian languages. 837-680-4102. You'll have somebody listening always. But stay connected and don't hesitate to seek help. Utkarsh, sadness is a mood. Like anger is a mood. Happiness is a mood. These are emotions we experience, which is okay. Depression is a clinical disease. 300 million people globally suffer from it. Depression is the world's single largest illness. In depression, you have sadness, which is pervasive for almost 2 weeks, with low moods, loss of interest, loss of pleasure, sleep appetite being affected, not being able to enjoy life, feeling worthless, hopeless, helpless, impairment of functioning in life. When this starts happening, it is depression. Depression is a medical illness because of biopsychosocial causes, where the biological component is neurotransmitter imbalance, for which you might require to take medical intervention. How do you, Veronica, how do you control thoughts during a pandemic? How do you control negative thoughts? Filter it. Every time you get a negative thought, go to the root. You will realize there was some faulty assumption, cognition, which was bringing this thought to you. You change it and convert it into a positive thought. Otherwise, talk to someone. Keep reading positive things. Keep filtering for only positive news, positive things. Invest in time, your time in things that you like doing. When you do things you like, you feel a lot better. Anand, if there are anxiety issues, there are various kinds of anxiety disorders, and there is anxiety which we can experience because of stress as well. If you're having anxiety which is related to these times, my suggestion, good lifestyle, good work ethic, take time for yourself, social connectedness, and a very, very hygienic lifestyle. If it's more happening for a long time, then you might need to talk to an expert. Ramanath Mishra ji, to come out of depression, my honest, strong, emphatic suggestion, please seek medical advice. Veronica, how do you monitor your mental health? See how happy you are, how content you are, sleep well, you look forward to spending time, your productivity is good. If you are enjoying what you are doing, your mental health is spot on. A pandemic, you know, it's pan mane sabko, everybody. So individualism, individualistic thoughts and concerns don't matter. What matters is all of us. If we bring compassion, connectedness, altruism, responsibility out of our closet and support each other, we'll win this fight. And remember, this is a cross-section of our life. In a longitudinal axis of our life, COVID is a cross-section. This will pass. The question is, when it passes, what version of mankind are we going to be? Would we have learned? Would we have learned that minimalistic living actually works for us? Would we have learned that the environment became better when we became more responsible? Would we learn that there were so many acts of altruism and positivity that were done by almost everybody around us, and the immense overwhelming work done by frontline workers and health workers, inspiring stories that we can share with generations to come? Would we learn that we can take care of our own selves? And would we learn that we had the resilience to fight a pandemic and come out of it? And then if mankind's version 2 is a compassionate version of its own self, that's what we want COVID to teach us when it leaves us. For ideal routine during COVID times, Shobha Mishra ji, my suggestion, keep a fixed wake-up time, have a work window before and after which you are not working, adequate sleep, avoid substances, avoid caffeine, hydrate well, eat at regular intervals, physical activity, yoga, meditation, some creativity, music, relaxation, lots of social connectedness, family time. Anand Shankar, you're right. Financial issues can be and is a concern for a lot of people. This is where I think support systems count. We need to help people during these times. We need to support them. And for individuals who've gone through a struggle in their jobs, remember, it's a tsunami that's affected everybody. It's not your individual fault. Don't be self-critical. Don't allow your self-esteem or confidence to go down. Once this settles and life comes back on track, you are the same person, same education, same abilities, same effort. When you will put it all over again, you will be back on your path of success. Just stay optimistic, no matter how tough it is. How do you identify the triggers for panic? So different people may have different triggers. Sometimes it is places and situations. Sometimes it can be caffeine, nicotine, cannabis. Sometimes it can be situations. So you need to, within your own self, see if there is a trigger factor. But panic attacks can also happen in absence of a trigger, right? Which is, which are unexpected panic attacks. And if that happens in a routine, this could be a part of an anxiety disorder. And I would suggest medical advice. Ramanath Mishra, I agree. Lots of people, you know, the moment you have a bit of a sore throat, we feel it, could it be COVID? Two things. You'd rather always keep yourself safe. So use this anxiety in a positive manner. But if it starts preoccupying you, divide your time in doing something else, because you can't really afford that you allow your life to be taken away by a fear. Kumar, Anshuman, people who are having more issues with the work from home are also people who are not able to give a break. So that mental break and that mental and physical demarcation of having a workstation, work time, and splitting and creating a healthy lifestyle and pattern is what is important. That's the only way we'll be able to do it. Multiple short breaks. Work in short spurts, take short breaks. Then this whole memory concentration issues will be settled much well. Utkarsh, not merely one particular illness or condition. Let me explain all mental health conditions to you in a more, look at a biopsychosocial model. Bio, which is genetics, biology, anatomy, physiology, biochemicals. Social, which is the environment. Psychological, our own self, our personality, our traits, our approach. This is what causes the illness. This is where the treatment is, which means biological, medication, psychological therapy. Social, you utilize the support systems. You put this together, that's your etiology and treatment for you. Narendranath Mishraji, I completely agree that there is still a lot of stigma around mental health, and I'm happy that Health Power Media had this interaction. I would request not just you, but all of you in media, in social media houses, keep having conversations on mental health. Encourage positive dialogue on mental health. Make sure that negative, faulty narratives, which increase stigma, increase myth around mental health, are discouraged. And correct information is encouraged. It's our collective responsibility that all of us put together, we create an awareness around mental health. Because generations have struggled because of stigma. Even today, 75% of people who require mental health intervention do not take help because they are worried about the stigma. So we need to collectively change the narrative, the conversation around mental health. So on that note, this is me saying a goodbye to all of you. Thank you for having this conversation. Let this conversation be a continuation. Let this be a start, and let us all continue on our path to end the stigma. And remember, as the World Suicide Prevention Day comes, there is so much that Papa Gino can teach you. Follow us on our social media handles as we continue to talk about how life is beautiful as Papa Gino learns. Thank you.